Hello, everyone, and welcome once again to the Connecticut Bowling Operators Association's Duck Pin Challenge. We're back here at the T-Bowl Lanes for another and exciting series of duck pin matches featuring the best bowlers in the game today. I'm Joe Schwager. My co-host is Craig Self. And Craig, tell us about our bowlers today.
Joe, today we've got Debbie Concannon from Torrington bowling against Carol McQuillan from Brookfield. The winner of that first match will take on Kathy Dyack from Rockville to determine today's champion.
Our defending champion, Kathy Dyack, and we'll be back to start our first match of the day right after this.
And welcome back to the T-Bowl Lanes in Newington for the second installment of our ladies division here of the CBOA Duckpin Challenge. Craig, how about a little recap of our three bowlers today?
Well, our first bowler is Debbie Concannon. Debbie's a fine bowler from Torrington who has been bowling now for 20 years.
And carrying a fine 122 average.
And her opponent will be Carol McQuillan from Brookfield, Connecticut, has an average of 132. The winner of that match will face our champion from 2 weeks ago, Kathy Dyack, number one bowler in the state of Connecticut.
And our first match today is Debbie Concannon and Carol McQuillan bowling for that right to try to unseed the King of the Hill, our champion, Kathy Dyack, and Debbie Concannon first frame.
Debbie's first ball is in the 1-3 pocket and it leaves a rather difficult spare leaf.
Two ways to go on this one. Light on either the 4 or the 5 pin. She's trying on the outside, picking off the 7.
Now she'll try to make 9 for the frame.
High single game of 207 and 3-game series of 495 for Debbie, whose husband Miles is also a very fine duck pin bowler. And 9 in the first frame. Now we have Carol McQuillan. Resident of Brookfield, Connecticut. First frame, very nice follow through for Carol. Crowd's yelling for a few more, and got a few more that made it more difficult.
Well, we're seeing the tough spares early. The goalposts
concentration. Going to look for one and one here. Practice your singles.
Trying to make your 10 for the frame. Oh, Carol slipped on that one. Hope she's all right.
The little ball covered the 10. And a one pin lead.
What happens occasionally in bowling is that a bowler will inadvertently step in a spot of water or soda that might have been dropped and causes you to come up quick on that lane. Oh, she came back with a strike.
That's and stuck in the right spot right there. You can see a good mix on this ball.
This ball's delivered right into the 1-2 pocket. The flyback comes over and takes out the 3 and the 6.
Everything moving to the right. Very good mix. Debbie Kincannon, second frame.
Oh, I thought we had an answer. Debbie will go for a spare here.
Ball glancing off a little bit, not carrying through to the 5. Throw that same pitch and cover the spare. And there you have it. And spare in the second frame for Debbie Kincannon. She's down by 1.
Debbie trying for a large fill here. She gets a 9 fill in this frame.
Leaving herself with the 8 pin. It's a larger fill as you can get without throwing the square one. Nine drop. Okay. Covers the spare in the third frame. 2 spares for Debbie. And we'll be back to continue with our first match right after these messages. And here we are, continuing with our first match. Debbie Kincannon out of the gate, 9 spare spare, and this is Carol McQuillan. 10 in the first, strike in the second. Pretty ball, pretty ball. Almost covering that second one, leaving yourself with a 7 pin.
Joe, there's a prize for consecutive strikes. If you score three strikes in a row, it's a $50 bonus.
And just barely passing by that seven pin. Well, we have our defending champion in the men's division, John Durrani, picked up the $50 bonus in last week's competition. And nine out in the third for Carroll. 38 and a tie ball game. Now watch the follow through on Carroll here. Very deliberate and excellent extension. That's the only way that ball is going to go where you want it to.
She reaches right out there as though she were going to shake hands with that head pin, and that's exactly what you want to do. And I think she deserved a little better from that hit, but that's duck pin bowling.
Now, though the results weren't quite what she would have liked, if you consider the aspects of what happened there, that ball got away from her at the line. But that follow through that she has kept it on track, almost gave her the strike, and that almost gave her the slide for the spare. Looking at the 5-10, third ball in the fourth. And nine for a score of 47, and Debbie Kincannon, 38 with the spare up in the third.
Debbie has taken a good deal of the last 2 years off from bowling. She had her baby daughter Kirsten 2 years ago, and she's just coming back to league bowling this year.
Sliding off a head pin to the right, leaving herself with a 1-2-7. Usually a bit a little better off here with this shot to go into the 1-2 with the ball and let the ball do the work on the 7.
You said it.
Nice shot by Debbie.
That's her third. Here's Debbie coming up on her third consecutive spare.
Ball's going to be just full enough to drive the 2-pin back over to the 7, carrying off the spare there. And a 7-pin lead, 8-pin lead. Fifth frame for Deb. Pretty ball, solidly into the 1-2.
Duck pin bowling is a game of spares more than strikes, Joe. In other games, you're looking for the strike every frame. In duck pins, you're very happy if you have 8 or 9 spares in a game.
I'm very happy if I have 2 or 3.
Are you really?
And there's the fourth one of the game for Debbie Kincannon, enjoying a 17-pin lead after 4. And let's see if the good duck pin bowling form of Carol McQuillan can help her back up here. Ball not driving through to the 5-pin there, leaving her with a very difficult 4-5-7-8.
If the ball is driven off the right-hand side of the 4-pin, there's a good chance for a flyback across to pick up the 5. Oh, and we did it just in reverse.
Not quite the way they diagram it in the book, but hey, if it works, do it. Outside on the triangle, the ball carrying the 7-pin and the 4-pin driving off the 8 all the way across to the wall and said, I know somebody's out there. Here he is. Bang. Count ball for Carol.
She's given herself an opportunity here to show us some fantastic spares if she keeps making them.
Ill faith, hope, and charity, 5, 7, and 10. And she gave it a try.
It was certainly close.
Should make 1-pin here. And off a little bit to the side, and we'll have Carol down by 12 pins plus a count by Debbie. Debbie Kincannon, 64 through 4, spare up in the 5th, first ball in the 6th. And no luck, a little washout to the right-hand side, 7 and 8 remaining. whole key to Debbie's approach and game, I think, Craig, is her beginning right there at the back of the approach.
I can see tremendous concentration in Debbie at the stance. And I was watching her in practice earlier, and she was throwing a very, very good ball. But she's very deliberate today.
And 10 out in the sixth.
Here's Debbie with her approach and slide. Follow through. Look at their feet are pointing right down toward the target, perpendicular to the foul line, exactly the way you want it.
And ball driving a little bit heavy, leaving yourself with the 2, 4, and 6. As I said, the key almost book perfect. Ball right at waist level at the start of the approach. Waiting to clear a pin from the channel. Ball right at waist level at the start of the approach so that you have the pendulum swing. You can put the ball in motion, but yet not have to drive it too far. Shoulder high in the back and then follow through.
There was a little rush on that push away at the start of her approach there. Now that was a smoother push away.
Okay, she's enjoying an 18-pin lead over Carol McQuillan. And we're going to be back with the conclusion of our very first match right after this. Welcome back, and we're going to go to the last three frames here in our first match. This is Carol McQuillan, down by 18 pins over Debbie Kincannon.
That's the first frame that Carolyn has not had a piece of the head pin, the number one pin. She hit directly on the three and got a lot of action out of it.
Looks like she knew what she was doing, though.
Got a nice bare leave.
Get over.
Rushed the delivery just a hair.
Looking for 10 to remain down 18 sticks. There it is. 82 for Carol in the seventh, 100 for Debbie Kincannon.
Carolyn started her bowling career at the age of 16 down in Bridgeport. Now she bowls at Perillo's in Waterbury.
And once again off the head pin, leaving herself with the 1, 3, 6, and 9. 1984 composite state average of 128 and our highest league average 131. Not bad at all. That ball a little bit full, picking off the head pin. Debbie's going to have the opportunity to drive a few nails in here in the next two frames.
Yeah, and I have a feeling that Debbie's determination here is going to put her in good stead.
$100, $125 to the loser this match, and a guarantee of $200 to the winner. Yeah, nice hit, but it's moving around, leaving her with the five and the seven.
Here we are. We're looking at a 5-7 leave here that had an opportunity. Probably came within an inch of the five pin. Like to pick up that 10 for the frame.
And there's 9 for 109, 17-10 lead. And of course, the winner of this match will face our champion, Kathy Dyack from Rockville, Connecticut, and have the all-important opportunity not just to pick up the $400, but to return in 2 weeks and defend their crown. Didn't hurt a thing, leaving the seven pin.
This is the all-important foundation frame, and she's going into it with a 17-pin lead. If she makes this strike, a spare, she's going to be awful tough.
Young lady, but a 20-year veteran of the duck pin game. And pulled that one up a bit. Again, passing the seven on the left-hand side. The door's not closed for Carol now. She's down by 16 pins, two frames remaining. She could put two marks on the board here, put a little bit of pressure on Debbie. Luck has not been with her this match. She could be saving an offer right here.
That came awful close to being a strike, and she really does need that strike. That's when you start picking up a lot of extra wood, is when you put three or four strikes together.
Again,
she tripped.
A little trip at the line and down. And 10 out. It appears that possibly because of the fact that Carol's the only one having that problem there, and it seemed both times it was on the left-hand lane. It may not just be her shoe. It may be a spot right where Carol is sliding. It definitely may not be hitting.
Joe, right now the possibility is that Carol would spare, and their highest game could be 122. Debbie Cannon has 118.
Well, there is the spare for Carol.
Now, if she could get a 10 fill on this, and it'd be still very, very difficult to win the match, I'm afraid. Carol's a mother of three. She's an accountant by profession.
Did just about all she could there. 121.
121. It means Debbie needs four to win. This ball is coming right into the 1-2 pocket. Excellent fly back in both the front and the back of that five pin. There's your champion of this match.
That pin to spin out. There's no time clock in this game.
That's right.
Spinning pin is concerned.
It's kind of like baseball in that respect. Her spare.
Spare.
Looking at a possible 138 game.
Debbie will be going on to meet one of grand ladies of the Duckpin game, our defending champion, Kathy Dyack. And another quick eight pins for a final score of 136. And we'll have that second match for you right after these messages. And we're back at the T-Bow in Newington for our second and final match of the afternoon. Our challenger, Debbie Kincannon from Torrington, Connecticut, against our defending champion from Rockville, Connecticut, Kathy Dyack. Debbie, the winner of our first match against Carol McQuillan.
And of course, Kathy won 2 weeks ago in the initial program.
And off to the right, breaking the 1, 2, 4, and 8. Looking to come out of the gate here in the first frame with a mark.
Aha.
And a little bit heavy.
Ball driving
the pin off. Ball forcing the pin to do the work here for it. Two pin back off, finding the 8. And the first ball of the day for Kathy Dyack.
Kathy will go inside on this.
Kathy looked like she may have slipped just a bit at the line that time. She's coming in cold. Dropped away from her a bit.
Over the years, Kathy, of course, has been one of the more stylish bowlers, and her delivery is imitated.
Craig, I had the pleasure in 1983 of being head of a contingent in the U.S. That took a group up to Canada for the International Cup, and Kathy was a member of that team there. And it was a great pleasure having a lady of her prominence on and off the lanes representing our country.
Well, I'll tell you, I've enjoyed talking with her prior to the matches. She's certainly a very, very nice woman to talk to. That Canadian match that you were talking about, is that the one where people from Argentina?
Argentina, Philippines, Canada, and U.S., and a tough spare for Kathy, the 1, 3, and 8. Ball doing the work. Pushing the head pin all the way back and through, and Debbie Kincannon coming up on a spare in the first frame.
Debbie left herself a very makeable spare.
Debbie almost looks like she's concentrating even harder up there this time.
Oh, I think I would if I were bowling the number one bowler.
Big point here, it doesn't matter that Kathy's number one in the state. Kathy's number one in this event right now, and she's the one that you have to unseat from the top.
Okay, nine for the frame.
And 26 through two, Kathy with 19 plus. Moving over to the third frame. Off to the right.
She seems to be searching again for her line. She had it in the first match against Carol. With the exception of one frame, she had a piece of the head pin.
Seems to be crossing back and forth a bit. Ball took a little double bounce there. You could hear it. Bouncing, it can't be catching the lane and turning where you want it. That was nice and solidly out, shaving the head pin down. 36 in the third, and we're going to be back with our champion, Kathy Dyack, right after we give you these messages. Welcome back to the T-Bowl for this week's championship match. And right back there in the stands, a young man in the purple shirt lending little support to his fellow bowlers, John Durante, our defending men's champion. We'll be seeing him next week. And here's our defending ladies' champion, Kathy Dyack. That was on a spare there. 25 in the second puts her down by one. Nice try on a very spread out four pinner. Needs this one to keep it tied. Be down by one.
Kathy started her bowling career in Baltimore, where she was raised, and moved to Connecticut several years after she started bowling. And I guess she had bowled 16 years when she attained the number one ranking in the nation.
She told us a couple weeks ago maybe she should have moved to Connecticut earlier, and she could have been number one even more times.
Well, she held that position seven different times.
Number one bowler in Connecticut, 1984. And that's part of the reason why. Spare in the fourth for Kathy Dyack.
See if Debbie's found that line that she's looking for again.
Again, a little double bump on that ball. I think you can hear it. It's taking a bounce. And when it takes that second bounce, it's your hands off of it. There's no way you can reach out and move it back where you want it.
Well, any English that you impart to the ball will come off when that ball bounces. That's why it should be rolled smoothly out, probably coming in contact with the lanes anywhere between 6 inches and 2 foot in front of the foul line. And the English would stay on the ball if it's rolled out smoothly. That's where you get your action.
Well, with the lane conditions the way they are today, they're much, much more accommodating to a little longer toss out over the line, as much as 4 to 8 feet. But the thing is, when you get a little bit of loft, or if you drop it close to the line out of your hand, it can do nothing but bounce right back up.
This particular spare leave is, of course, very difficult. I have seen this made in competition, though, on the ladies' pro tour. Nice try.
Almost popping the five pin back. Final ball for Debbie.
Nine frame.
And 54 through the fifth. Kathy Dyack, 45 plus. One more ball here in the fourth for that count. And she'll be up by this first ball. Kathy again doing a little bit of that magic she does so well. Ball getting away to the right, leaving herself the two pinner, 1-2. This could put her up by nine and another ball.
Perfect.
1-2 punch.
You always want to try to hit in between the two pins rather than go from the outside.
+63 for Kathy halfway through the match. 54 for Debbie.
Well, we still have a nice spare leave there. Kathy uses the entire approach, about 15 and a half feet of it, in a four-step approach.
Turning too much. Like 10, 480 in the six, a 16 pin lead for Kathy. And look at the follow through, right at shoulder level.
The shoulders are parallel with the foul line. That's the way you deliver a nice straight ball. That's the best first ball that Debbie's delivered now in a couple of frames.
And catching the seven pin for a spare. You know, Greg, when a lot of people hear the term the shoulders being parallel to the foul line, they feel that They have to be very stiff all the way up, keeping the shoulders parallel all the way, but that's not necessarily the case.
There's a difference between square and parallel. A lot of people think you're talking about being absolutely parallel as far as the squareness. And you can drop one shoulder slightly, but as long as you're facing squarely.
And a nice nine drop for Debbie. The important thing, of course, is where you finish, not how you get there.
Do you mean in pinfall?
That too. Going for the five pin. Ball bouncing out. She's down by seven, but we have three frames remaining. And covering it for 10 and 83 in the seventh. And we're going to be back for the conclusion of our championship match right after this.
And we're back for the final frames of our championship match, the Connecticut Bowling Operator Association Duck Pin Challenge. And our reigning champion, Kathy Dyack, is up for the seventh frame. And again, Gray, she continues to pass by the head pin, but continues to leave herself with the spare bricks.
There's our spare.
And Kathy now with a seven-pin lead over Debbie Kincannon. It's the state record for six games of 969. 161-pin average for six games.
That ball dropped again.
Unfortunately, that one didn't get away from her as much as the last few. Caught a piece of the head and left herself with a 5, 6, 9, and 10. Let's see how she shoots this, the way her ball is turning.
That was absolutely the textbook spare.
That's the way the shot is made.
Here it comes into the left side of the 6. The 6 takes the 10 and comes back and gets the 5. Absolutely perfect.
Debbie Kincannon down by 13, coming up in the eighth frame. And ball running out, leaving herself a difficult spare break here.
Difficult but makeable.
Usually what happens on this shot, hitting light into the 1-2, you may carry the 7, leave the 9, or heavy on the outside of the 1. Pins may split around the 7, but she hit that one right on the nose.
We are seeing some spares made now. Here it comes into the 1-2 pocket. The 1 drives back and takes out the rear pin, and the ball goes over with the 2.
Ball gave every pin an assignment that time, and they all followed through. On a spare in the 9th.
Now this spare.
Excuse me, what'd you say?
Supposing the 8 had remained standing, would have been more difficult than the spare she made in the previous box frame. I go back to school tomorrow.
For the spare in the 9th, Debbie Kincannon. Is he going to catch? No, turn in too much.
Didn't take advantage of it.
And that's the way it should have gone. 10 in the 9th for 111. Kathy Dyack, 106 in a count in the 8th. And here she comes for her last 2 shots of the game. Here we go once again, off to the right. This is probably one of the more difficult spares she's left with that ball.
It definitely is.
1, 2, and 7.
Ball into the 1-2 pocket here. The 2 goes over and takes out the 7, or else the ball itself might. Well, we're coming in the other way. Just as though all 4 of them had been standing.
Right down the line.
Pin to pin to pin.
+123 in the 9th for Kathy, 12 pin lead plus a count.
I would say that Kathy is starting to make Debbie's job look a little difficult. Debbie has a possible 141 if she strikes.
With 9 on the first ball here, Kathy assures herself of no less than a tie. And chopping through the middle.
The match is not over.
Taking out the 1, 5, 8, and 9.
16 pin lead in the 9th frame.
Still holds Debbie on at least a double no matter what she does here.
Say again? I believe 131 if that goes in the hole in the one slot again.
I'll still need a double to win.
I think at this point perhaps any combination of strike and spare would tie this match. Double to win.
Biggest ball of the day for Debbie.
Well, you always like to make this spare. Never more than right now.
Not at all happy with the way that ball turned for.
She's looking for either side of the 5 pin. One way you hit the ball directly. Now she's going for a direct. She got it.
She got her shot.
This is the type of shot in duck pin bowling that everyone wants to get every time out. When you leave the 5-10 or the 5-7, and you can convert it, it makes your day.
10 pins ties it. Anything less than 10 laying flat. And we still have ourselves a defending champion on top. Kathy Dyack, our winner, and we'll be back to it just right after this.
And back at the T-Ball Lanes in Newington, Connecticut for our second ladies' contest in the Connecticut Bowling Operators Association Great Duck Pin Challenge. And Craig, how about a recap of today's scores?
Well, today's scoring was not high considering the games that the contestants have thrown, but we saw some excellent spare conversions today, some fine shooting on spares that normally you wouldn't make.
And gentlemen who very proud to see things like that, the president of the Connecticut Bowling Operators Association, Mr. Dick Bisson. We're learning something new every show, Dick. Now it's spare shooting.
It certainly was. It was excellent spare shooting exhibition today. It's too bad there weren't more strikes, though.
Well, I can't wait till next week and see what he's got in store for us then. Now we're going to give out the awards for this week's program. Our third place finisher, Carol McQuillan. Finishing second, very close, not quite unseating our defending champion from Torrington, Connecticut, Debbie Concannon.
Nice bowling, Deb.
Well, you came close. You gonna give it another shot?
Oh, certainly. Gonna come back and get Kathy again sometime.
Have you ever bowled this lady head-to-head before?
Not that I can remember. Not a head-to-head match.
Well, next time you'll be 500, right?
I hope so.
Thanks, Debbie. Good luck in the future. And once again, our defending champion in first place of $400 from Rockville, Connecticut, Kathy Dyack.
Thank you.
How long are we going to go on meeting like this?
I hope for a long time. But I think somebody up there likes me after what I pulled in the 10th box, going through the hole.
Well, I tell you, I asked you all the questions last time. You have any questions for me?
No, not really.
Okay, you can ask the other ones later.
Oh.
Okay, Kathy, you're going to be back in 2 weeks to defend the crown one more time. One thing you haven't done yet in your career in the game is that world record game, and if you can do it 2 weeks from now, that 266, $10,000. What do you think?
Oh, that sounds terrific.
Okay, is that going to be a promise?
I'll try.
All righty, and good luck to you in 2 weeks. We'll see you then. And we'll be back next week with the men's competition. Our defending champion, John Durante, will be back with two new challengers. And Dick Bisson, you ready to do it again?
Certainly.
All righty, for Craig's self and myself, Joe Schwager, we'll be back with more from the Connecticut Bowling Operators Association Duckpin Challenge.